welcome everyone to the Dr. Todd Talks Tunes show. I am your host, Dr. Todd Samra, and today we have a fantastic episode for you. Fantastic episode on Barry Gibb and why he is such a great melodist, why he's such a great melody maker. He's actually a magical melody maker. And I think part of the reason for their success, especially in the early days, of the Bee Gees, remember that they were the three boys, Robin, Maurice, and Barry, were all born in Manchester and then moved to Brisbane, Australia when they were young boys, and they still consider that to be their home. Anyway, they kind of came in on the dovetails of the Beatles, and they were, even their first record was even produced by a manager of the Beatles, and the sound of the group definitely was akin to the sound of the Beatles. But the real reason I think they sounded like the Beatles is because of their ability to craft these great melodies. And that's really what the Beatles did so well. They crafted so many different melodies. We have songs by the Beatles. We don't even really know what genre to put that song in. I mean, that's true with other groups too. You think about Pink Floyd and Vera from The Wall. Vera! Vera! What genre is Vera? Like, by itself, it's kind of, you know, an interesting question. And that also is related to the influence of the Beatles. And so, really what we see here is this great craftsmanship in writing melodies. And that's part of the reason I think they became legendary. They just didn't simply replace the Beatles in terms of writing on their coattails. They forged their own way. The Bee Gees, by the way, is alphabetically just after the Beatles in the record store. Remember the record store? You know, when you go through. So the Bee Gees, I mean it all, Barry Gibb, it's all kind of related. I want to start today with How Deep Is Your Love, which is in the key of E flat, which is, as we've mentioned in other episodes, is the key of a lot of love songs. And just to remind you, look at this little spot. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start by playing three notes. And it starts with this one. And I go up a half step. And I go up another half, or a whole step. And if we look at these three notes together, this is where the whole line is going. And this relates all the way back to classical craftsmanship. So remember, here's the first one. The next one, now that's the highest note. Now here's the third one. And it comes back down. That's just good writing. Now this next section, he's going to go higher. He's going to go up here. So he's working his way back down the same way. He's skipping a little bit. We get to C, on to the F. Now to E flat, the next note down in the scale. And then we get this. Then a short little back up. That's kind of a contrasting kind of little melody there. But really, if you look at the craftsmanship of that and how he's working up, it's going to go not note higher, this phrase. Bum, ba, ba. All the way to so. So. It's really great writing. Another one I want to bring to our attention today is How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? And part of the reason I want to look at this one is because it makes use of this major 7 chord, which is a beautiful chord. And, you know, Color My World. It's that chord. And he's using that note of the chord as the primary note in the melody to start with. Now the chord's going to go up, but the melody's going to go down. Thank you. And then you're just basically going to repeat that idea. But the way that the chord is very open and then closes in. A step on the bottom and a step on the top. I mean, it's really very, you know, kind of a quality voice leading, you know, really elegant craftsmanship that we have in that song. And the other thing I like about this song is it starts out almost like what we, like recitative. And if you're in, you're an opera person, you know what that is. In opera, there's the whole opera is sung. Well, not everything can be like a beautiful song. Sometimes they have just dialogue. And so they'll, you know, make like recitative, like, what are we having for breakfast? I don't know. Bacon and eggs sounds good to me. Don't burn the bacon, please. I like it when it's really crispy, but don't bacon too much. I like bacon and sausage. You know, you can find this recitative. It's very speech-like. And we look at the beginning of this, and it's just like that. I can think of younger days when living for this life was everything a man could want to do. Then he now gets more melodic. And he leaves you hanging. And that's going to be the melody note. And that closing down again, it's just really well crafted. I mean, there's a reason why we like these songs. There's a reason why we gravitate towards them. They're really good. They're really well crafted. I think one of the greatest things that Barry Gibb did in his career was the partnership that he made with Barbra Streisand when they did the album Guilty. I think there's just some tremendous songwriting on that album and some tremendous performance. And I want to point out today a song from that album, the song Woman in Love, which is in E flat minor, which has six flats in the key signature. You're like, what? Six flats? Who writes an E flat minor? Well, unless your name is like Chopin, not very many people. It's not really a very common thing. So why would he do that? Why would he have this whole part of the song, this complicated chords and all this stuff, be in E flat minor? Well, it's because he was writing it specifically for Barbara. And this is a tradition that really goes way back. One example is Bach. Bach wrote Cantata 51, BWV 51, Jauchzet Gott, for a specific castrato who he gave it to. He walked all the way to Dresden, gave it to him, and the guy just threw it in the trash. He dug it out of the trash, and that's how we have Jauchzet Gott. But he wrote it specifically for the singer, for his skill set. He had heard him sing before. Well, he's doing that with Barbara here. And what he's doing, he's setting it up so that towards the end of the song, we have a modulation up a half step, which amps up the energy. That's why they do that. That's why Barry Manilow does that. That's why that happens in so many songs. So it's going to end in E minor, which is a much easier, it says one sharp, so it's much easier to play in. But what he's really doing is he's setting it up for this. That little high point there. And what he's doing is he's putting it right at the right spot in Barbara's voice. So she's not going beyond her break. Because Barbara's like a mezzo-soprano. She's like a belter. So, wah. She's got all this richness and depth in her voice. And so you don't want to like extend her up too high because she's going to lose some of that power. So this it's a right I defend. I'm trying to do that kind of softly, but it's hard to do. But it's right in this power grippy spot. So in this song, all these complicated chords and all of these wonderful relationships, and he had to start out in E, take it down in E flat minor, so that he could work up to the optimal key for her voice at the end in regular E minor. So here we go. So there's some complicated chords there. D flat minor is this one. And he repeats that idea. It's very Beatles-like in that it definitely has a folk song quality to it. He's kind of building the energy here. I am a woman in love, and I'll do anything to get you into my world and hold you within. It's a right I defend over and over again. But then he's going to set it up even later with a, I am a woman in love, and I'm talking to you. Go. Brilliant. He's custom writing this. The last example I want to mention today is what I opened with, and that's Greece. And because, just to put it right out front, the secret to this song is it's a hook. Now, of course, this is from the musical Greece, and I think it's the best song from the musical Greece. And I think they must have thought that too, because they put it first and they named the musical or the song after the musical. So, and if you really compare it to a lot of the other music in Greece, it's supposed to be, you know, a 1970s version retro of what the 1950s were. So we have Sha-na-na, we have Grease Lightning, we've got, you know, Beauty School Dropout, we have all this 50s style music, and we have this. This does not fit the profile. This song is cool. So it contrasts really the rest of the musical, but what they needed was just a really great hook. So who are you going to go to write you that really great hook for your show that you can hook people in? Barry Gibb. So check this out. He's going to do that same thing where now he's a half step higher than we started. Not complicated. A lot of repeated notes. Really simple. Because he's trying to create it like a hook. You don't want to make it too complex. You don't want to have it be too thematically complex just to go there with it. Because you want to hook people in. Short, sweet, motivic ideas, and then that kind of brings people in. And that was really, I think, a big key to the success of this musical, was that I remember going to see it in the late 1970s, you know, and you got grabbed right from the very beginning, really because of the power of this particular song. I mean, it's such a great song, it's such a great hook, and it kind of, energy-wise, it's cool and easy, and it pulls you into the show kind of effectively. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. This is a little bit like the Elton John episode we did. Next week, we're going to do the Mozart paradox. So tune into that, because we're going to talk about, like, you know, where's the Mozart today? Like, for real. Like, you know, where's the Mozart? It's going to be very exciting. Tune in next week. Anyway, thank you for tuning in today, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you again next time. Thank you for watching Dr. Todd Talks Tunes. And don't forget to subscribe to Todd Samra Music. Thank you.